Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart, confessing our sins unto God our Father, beseeching him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord. O Almighty God, merciful Father, I, a poor, miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities with which I have ever offended you and justly deserved your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them and sincerely repent of them. And I pray you of your boundless mercy and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor, sinful being. Upon this, your confession, I, by virtue of my office, called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God and all of you, and in the stead, and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all of your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Nothing you have made, and forgive the sins of all who are penitent. Create in us new and contrite hearts, that lamenting our sins and acknowledging our wretchedness, we may receive from you full pardon and forgiveness, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Almighty God, by your great goodness, mercifully look upon your people, that we may be governed and preserved evermore in body and soul, through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. First Lenten reading, Psalm 119, beginning at the 105th verse. Your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. I have sworn an oath and confirmed it to keep your righteous rules. I am severely afflicted. Give me life, O Lord, according to your word. Accept my free will offerings of praise, O Lord, and teach me your rules. I hold my life in my hand continually, but I do not forget your law. The wicked have laid a snare for me, but I do not stray from your precepts. Your testimonies are my heritage forever, for they are the joy of my heart. I incline my heart to perform your statutes forever to the end. I hate the double-minded, but I love your law. You are my hiding place and my shield. I hope in your word. Depart from me, you evildoers, that I may keep the commandments of my God. Uphold me according to your promise, that I may live, and let me not be put to shame in my hope. Hold me up, that I may be safe, and have regard for your statutes continually. You spurn all who go astray from your statutes, for their cunning is in vain. All the wicked of the earth you discard like dross. Therefore I love your testimonies. My flesh trembles for fear of you, and I am afraid of your judgments. I have done what is just and right. Do not leave me to my oppressors. Give your servant a pledge of good. Let not the insolent oppress me. My eyes long for your salvation and for the fulfillment of your righteous promise. Deal with your servant according to your steadfast love and teach me your statutes. I am your servant. Give me understanding that I may know your testimonies. It is time for the Lord to act, for your law has been broken. Therefore, I love your commandments above gold, above fine gold. Therefore, I consider all your precepts to be right. I hate every false way. This is the word of the Lord. The Holy Gospel, according to St. John, the 11th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Now a certain man was ill, Lazarus of Bethany, the village of Mary, and her sister Martha. It was Mary who anointed the Lord with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair, whose brother Lazarus was ill. So the sisters sent to Jesus, saying, Lord, he whom you love is ill. But when Jesus heard it, he said, the illness does not lead to death. It is for the glory of God, so that the Son of God may be glorified through it. Now Jesus loved Martha and her sister and Lazarus. So when he heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. Then after this, he said to the disciples, let us go to Judea again. The disciples said to him, Rabbi, the Jews were just now seeking to stone you. And are you going to go there again? Jesus answered, are there not 12 hours in the day? If anyone walks in the day, he does not stumble because he sees the light of this world. But if anyone walks in the night, he stumbles because the light is not in him. After saying these things, he said to them, our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I go to awaken him. The disciples said to him, Lord, if he's fallen asleep, he will recover. Now Jesus had spoken of his death, but they thought he meant taking rest in sleep. Then Jesus told them plainly, Lazarus has died. And for your sake, I am glad that I was not there so that you may believe. But let us go to him. So Thomas, called the twin, said to his fellow disciples, Let us also go, that we may die with him. Now when Jesus came, he found that Lazarus had already been dead in the tomb for 4 days. Bethany was near Jerusalem, about 2 miles off, and many of the Jews had come to Martha and Mary to console them concerning their brother. So when Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went and met him, but Mary remained seated in the house. Martha said to Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But even now I know that whatever you ask from God, God will give you. Jesus said to her, Your brother will rise again. Martha said to him, I know that he will rise again in the resurrection on the last day. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. Do you believe this? She said to him, Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who is coming into the world. When she had said this, she went and called her sister Mary, saying in private, The teacher is here and is calling for you. And when she heard it, she rose quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet come into the village, but was still in the place where Martha had met him. When the Jews who were with her in the house, consoling her, saw Mary rise quickly and go out, they followed her, supposing that she was going to the tomb to weep there. Now when Mary came to where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet, saying, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. When Jesus saw her weeping and the Jews who had come with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in his spirit and greatly troubled. And he said, Where have you laid him? They said to him, Lord, come and see. Jesus wept. So the Jews said, See how he loved him. But some of them said, Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man also have kept this man from dying? Then Jesus, deeply moved again, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone lay against it. Jesus said, Take away the stone. Martha, the sister of the dead man, said to him, Lord, by this time there will be an odor, for he has been dead 4 days. Jesus said to her, Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God? So they took away the stone. And Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this on account of the people standing around, that they might believe that you sent me. When he had said these things, he cried out with a loud voice, Lazarus, come out! The man who had died came out, his hand and feet bound with linen strips, and his face wrapped with a cloth. Jesus said to them, Unbind him and let him go. Many of the Jews, therefore, who had come with Mary and had seen what he had done, believed in him. But some of them went to the Pharisees and told what Jesus had done. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Thank you. each of you the peace and joy which come only through faith in our Lord and Savior Christ Jesus, the one who was, who is, and who is yet to come. Please be seated. The text for this evening's sermon is from John chapter 11. For many centuries, in divine service after divine service, the Christian church has confessed, I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. The writers of the Apostles' Creed added, I believe in the forgiveness of sins. They wanted to speak of the resurrection to eternal life with Christ. The forgiveness which Christ won for us by his innocent suffering and death, it is that which makes the resurrection of the body and the life everlasting a sure and blessed reality for everyone who believes in him as Lord and Savior. So whenever you confess faith in Christ, who is the resurrection and the life, you're confessing to God and to each other something that we consciously or unconsciously try to deny, the fact of our mortality, the fact that we will all one day die. But at the same time, Christians are admitting the thought of death would be absolutely unbearable unless he who is the resurrection and the life did die in your place. In other words, we say to God, to ourselves and to each other, I am indeed a sinner. I'm not as good as I pretend, and I indeed deserve nothing but punishment that the open grave awaits us all. Today's account begins with the account of Mary. She had anointed Christ with ointment and wiped his feet with her hair. There was also Martha, her sister, and their gravely ill brother Lazarus. They were all very good friends of Christ. But now they were in distress, and the sisters sent to Jesus saying, Lord, he whom you love is ill. If you read it, Christ seems rather unconcerned at receiving the news. He says, this illness does not lead to death, so even though he loved those three, when he heard that Lazarus was ill, he stayed 2 days longer in the place where he was. It was only then that he did say to his disciples, let us go to Judea again. Now, these disciples were a little bit on edge at this news. They were not at all keen to go back to the area near Jerusalem. They remembered what they had left, and so they said to Christ, Rabbi, the Jews were just now seeking to stone you, and are you going there again? Well, Christ gives the reason for his returning. He says, our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but I go to waken him. Well, this made the disciples doubly certain that they didn't really need to go back to that dangerous locale of Jerusalem, because if Lazarus was sleeping, that usually meant, according to popular folklore, that the fever had broken and that Lazarus would be getting better. But Christ told them what he really meant. He said, Lazarus has died, and for your sake, I am glad that I was not there, so that you may believe. Let us go to him. Well, Thomas spoke up for all of the disciples when he said, let us also go that we may die with him. You see, the disciples suddenly realized it was probably time for the dying that Christ had been so long talking about. And we have to say to their credit, at least at that moment, they were ready to go into death with their Lord. Little did they know what was going to happen, who it would be that would end up living, and who it would be that would end up dying. Well, when Christ and the 12 finally got to Lazarus' hometown just outside Jerusalem, Lazarus had been dead for 4 days. There were all kinds of Jews around. They were there to comfort Mary and Martha at the death of their brother. And the reason that Christ and his disciples were approaching, of course, would put them now into danger. They would be literally going into the hornet's nest. Martha was told that Christ was nearing their home, so she went out to meet him. She said to Christ, Lord, if you had been there, my brother would not have died, but even now I know that whatever you ask from God, God will give you. Understand that this was not an accusation. Martha was expressing great trust and absolute confidence in Christ. She knew his almighty power, and she knew what he could do. Nevertheless, Christ tested her. He said, "Your brother will rise again." And now, Martha, sensing by what Jesus said that for some reason Christ had decided not to raise Lazarus from the dead, Martha submitted to his apparent will, and she confessed faith that her brother would indeed rise again in the resurrection on the last day. And it was then that Christ spoke the comforting words that we also have so often heard, especially upon attending the funeral of a loved one. Jesus said, "I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet will he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die." And then he asked Martha, "Do you believe this?" And again, she makes the wonderful confession of faith which all who trust Christ will confess. "Yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who is coming into the world." Martha then sent word to her sister Mary that the teacher is here and he is calling for you. Christ wanted Mary to be there for what he next would do, but first he'd hear Mary's confession of faith. And indeed, when she arrived, Mary also knelt before him and said, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." You see, she also knew and she believed in both the power and in the love of Christ Jesus, her Savior. Next, we hear the shortest verse in the Bible. Asking to be taken to Lazarus' tomb, Christ surveys the crowd of people mourning the loss of Lazarus, all of them shedding sympathizing tears with Mary and Martha. And Scripture says, Jesus wept. Of course, the unbelievers and those who were unsatisfied with Christ because he hadn't done anything for them lately said things like, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man also have kept this man from dying?" This is all according to God's plan. Christ's word to Lazarus would confirm in faith Mary, Martha, his disciples, and all the others in the crowd who already believed in Christ. His words would convert others to faith in him, and the unbelieving, the rats, would scurry back to Jerusalem to tattle about what they had seen and would set in motion the final solution that the Pharisees had planned for Christ. So now Christ says, "Take away the stone." Martha, thinking that Jesus had no intention of raising her brother from the dead, thought that this was rather unwise, and so she quickly says, "Lord, by this time there will be an odor, for he has been dead for 4 days." But Christ reassured her. He wasn't trying to get a last good look at his friend. Remember that he had said to his disciples earlier, "This is so you may believe." And now he says to Martha, "Did I not tell you that if you believed, you would see the glory of God?" And so Christ was obeyed, and they took away the stone. He made absolutely no move to enter. Instead, Christ lifted his eyes toward heaven, and he prayed, "Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this on account of the people standing around, that they may believe that you sent me." And he then cried out with the full-throated voice of Almighty God himself, "Lazarus, come out!" And Lazarus came walking out of the tomb. Everyone was so astounded by what they heard and then what they saw, Christ had to tell them to remove his burial wrappings and let him go. Because can you imagine the chaos that must have ensued? Joy, wonder, shouting, fainting. Should we touch Lazarus? Should we not touch Lazarus? What's going on? But here's where things go now. They go toward the bottom line. Scripture says, following in John 11, many of the Jews who had come with Mary and had seen what he did believed in him. But some of them went to the Pharisees and told them what Jesus had done. When the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered, they said, "What are we to do? For this man does many signs. If we let him go on like this, everyone will believe in him, and the Romans will come and take away our place in our nation." But Caiaphas, who was high priest that year, said to them, "You know nothing at all, nor do you understand that it is better for you that one man should die for the people and that not the whole nation should perish." Now Caiaphas, he didn't say this of his own accord, Scripture says. As high priest that year, God used Caiaphas to tell the truth, that indeed Jesus would die for the nation, but not just for Israel. He would die to gather into one the children of God wherever they may be. Whereas the plans to kill Christ had been rather informal and very haphazard to this point, now they made plans which ultimately led them to the traitorous Judas. The raising of Lazarus put the church leaders over the top in their hatred. And yet, since it was not yet the right time, John 11 says this: "Jesus no longer walked openly among the Jews, but went from there to the region near the wilderness." Jesus was going to hide himself for a few days until the Saturday before what we call Palm Sunday. He then went to a meal at Mary and Martha and Lazarus' home. And many of the Jews spotted Christ Jesus, and they saw that he was with Lazarus. And it was then that the church leaders decided they needed to kill Lazarus also, because he was such a visible reminder of Christ's power. He was the reason that more and more people were flocking to Christ. And so now, the right time was approaching. Christ was about to boldly enter Jerusalem to the acclaim of the people. "Hosanna! Save us!" He would go into the temple, and he would drive out the money changers. He would prepare to celebrate the Passover with his disciples and to institute his Holy Supper. All was being readied. Christ was about to ascend the holy hill. There he would die for you and for me. And he would rise to prove his victory over sin and death and the devil. Into him, you are baptized for all his benefits. Him you receive as a glorious and gracious meal in the holy sacrament for forgiveness and for life. The final way is being prepared for the Lord. Hosanna, save us. Amen. Please rise for prayer.
Friends in Christ, I urge you all to lift up your hearts to God and pray with me, as Christ our Lord has taught us and freely promised to hear us. God our Father, look with mercy on us, your needy children on earth, and grant us grace that your holy name be hallowed by us and all the world through the pure and true teaching of your word and the fervent love shown forth in our lives. Graciously turn from us all false doctrine and evil living, whereby your precious name is blasphemed and profaned. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
May your kingdom come to us and expand. Bring all transgressors and those who are blinded and bound in the devil's kingdom to know Jesus Christ, your Son, by faith, that the number of Christians may be increased. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Strengthen us by your Spirit according to your will, both in life and in death, in the midst of both good and evil things, that our own wills may be crucified daily and sacrificed to your good and gracious will. Into your merciful hands we commend Norbert Badke, Ryan's father, who is near death, and all who are in need, praying for them at all times, thy will be done. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Grant us our daily bread, preserve us from greed and selfish cares, and help us trust in you to provide for all our needs. Lord, in your mercy,
Hear our prayer.
Forgive us our sins, as we also forgive those who sin against us, so that our hearts may be at peace and may rejoice in a good conscience before you, and that no sin may ever frighten or alarm us. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lead us not into temptation, O Lord, but help us by your Spirit to subdue our flesh, to turn from the world and its ways, and to overcome the devil with all his wiles. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And lastly, O Heavenly Father, deliver us from all evil of both body and soul, now and forevermore. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We trust, O Lord, in your great mercy to hear and answer us through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have eternal life. Grant us your Spirit, gracious Father, that we may give heed to the testimony of your Son in true faith, and above all firmly take to heart the words with which Christ gives to us his body and blood for our forgiveness. By your grace, lead us to remember and give thanks for the boundless love which he manifests to us, when by pouring out his precious blood, he saved us from your righteous wrath and from sin, death, and hell. Grant that we may receive the bread and wine, that is, his body and blood, as a gift, guarantee, and a pledge of his salvation. Graciously receive our prayers, deliver and preserve us. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship, with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
In the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, at his command and with his own words, we receive his testament. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." The same way also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament of my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me."
Depart in peace.
Thank you.
body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen and preserve you, body and soul, unto life everlasting. Depart in peace.
Give you peace.